Welcome to Followers Online. Today we start with a very serious problem. Science tells us that we tend to be drawn to people who are similar to us, or people who remind us of someone that we love, like our parents or our friends. We all know about the things that turn us off and turn us away from being near someone. They look dirty or ragged or weird or wild or dangerous or annoying. Science also says that we tend to make up our minds whether we find someone likable within the first moment or two, and then we base our whole relationship on that decision. The problem is, then we end up with a church of people who pretty much look like us and think like us and act like us, which doesn't welcome the rest of the community the way that Jesus wants us to. Rick says, in not so common sense, our series on the book of James, we look at how the apostle tackles favoritism in the church. He calls it a sin and a violation of God's love. But the problem is still with us. So we need to talk about playing favorites and the ins and outs of exclusion.
Lord, today we come before you admitting our problem with the powerful and popular people. We see those who are beautiful, rich, successful, athletic, talented, and smart, and so often we somehow think that they are better than the poor, deformed, or struggling folks that are around us. We know the truth is that you love us all, and we ask forgiveness for the times when we elevate one person over another just based on their looks or their talents. Help us to not defer to the influential or to be intimidated by them. And help us to be just as determined to lift up the lowly and anyone who appears to have less to offer, either us or society in general. Give us eyes that don't look at beauty and bank accounts, and instead see people in need of your love and grace, regardless of what they look like or how much they have. Help us also to remember that those who look like they have it all are often just as broken and hurting under their veneers of success, and they need you as well. Let us leave the judging to you and simply be a friend and a Christ ambassador to all we meet. In the name of Jesus, amen.
As we consider our favoritism problem, we recognize that we have to see people through the eyes of Jesus, the one who loves the whole world and who died for the whole world.
Let's sing this together. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved.
God loved us first, and now we have to internalize the idea that His love is permanent, all-encompassing, and filled with grace and mercy, regardless of what's hidden deep in your closet. His love is forever. This week, millions of people will fall into the trap of thinking that love is proved with flowers, chocolates, expensive dinners, and jewelry, when we know that the truest love we can possibly know was offered on a wooden cross for us before we even knew who our great love was. Some of the lyrics in this old hymn about the incredible love that God has shown to his people. It is measureless and strong and will endure long after we are gone to our heavenly home, where we will experience it for ourselves.
The love of God is greater far tongue or pen can never tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty bow down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from. Of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless.
Have you ever seen a reconciliation? It means there are two things that aren't right or that are at odds with each other. It might be your bank statement compared to how much money you thought you had, or two pieces of wallpaper that don't match up, or a couple of pieces of wood that come together at just the wrong angle. I always laugh when I think about the old commercial where there were two men cooperating to get a long hedge trimmed faster, and they agreed to cut the hedge at chest height, forgetting that they were different heights themselves. Some reconciliations involve people, and if you have seen one where two people who have been at odds with each other over a long period of time finally come back into forgiveness and into relationship again, it's a beautiful thing. I think that God loves reconciliation. Communion is also a time of reconciliation. We come here knowing there are two things that are not meeting: the perfect Jesus, the standard that God sets out for us, and us. But rather than that being a barrier between us and the Father, we get reconciliation. When it's your bank statement or wallpaper or wood or even hedges, the process usually involves some smoothing things out or redoing things or perhaps wrestling with the numbers until you see what the problem was. But in communion, things are brought into alignment with the grace of God. He sees where we don't match up to his high standard, and he adds his own mercy, grace, and love to smooth things over and help us come back together. The barriers, the mismatching, the inequities are gone. It's not a magical ceremony with magical bread and juice that makes us right with God, but a celebration that Jesus has already made us right. The distance is gone. The dividing walls are gone. We are reconciled. Let's pray. Father, let us celebrate our reconciliation with you. You do all the work, the easing and the repairing and the smoothing things over, and we get all the benefits. Thank you for this time of communion, and bless us. Bless all of those who are here to take some bread, some wine, and remember your death on the cross. In the name of Jesus, we say, amen.
Strong and kind, for the Lord.
Here's something that you could read this week. 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter of the Bible, a beautiful piece of poetry that reminds us of the height, depth, and reach of God's love. It ends with this remarkable thought. Three things will last: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Today we have a faith, but one day it will be unnecessary, for we will see God face to face. Today we have hope, but one day it will disappear as we find our place in heaven. Today we have love, and love will last.
My car, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. God, his son, not sparing, send him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. And take me home, where joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
As this week will demonstrate, we have fallen for the way that this world tends to quantify love. The love Jesus calls us to isn't the warm, fuzzy feelings and butterflies for all mankind, but the need to look at others equally and realize that we all have the same physical needs, the same mental needs, and the same need to know our God.
James chapter 2. My dear brothers and sisters, how can you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over others? For example, suppose someone comes into your meeting dressed in fancy clothes and expensive jewelry, and another comes in who is poor and dressed in dirty clothes. If you give special attention and a good seat to the rich person, but you say to the poor one, "You can stand over there or else sit on the floor," well, doesn't this discrimination show that your judgments are guided by evil motives? Listen to me, dear brothers and sisters. Hasn't God chosen the poor in this world to be rich in faith? Aren't they the ones who will inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? But you dishonor the poor. Isn't it the rich who oppress you and drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who slander Jesus Christ, whose noble name you bear? Yes, indeed, it is good when you obey the royal law as found in the scriptures. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if you favor some people over others, you are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. For the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's law. For the same God who said, "You must not commit adultery," also said, "You must not murder." So if you murder someone but do not commit adultery, you've still broken the law. So whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you.
I hope you were moved by the heartbreaking photos and videos and news that we saw coming out of Turkey and Syria this week. God wants us to feel compassion, and then he wants us to do something about that. Our congregation will be ensuring we take a special collection to help the victims of the earthquake in the best way possible, hopefully with matching funds from our government. After all, our giving reminder this week says, by practicing the grace of sharing, a person is storing up treasure for himself. Gifts are investments. One of the most powerful assurances of God's love for you is found in Romans 8, and I want to leave you with that today. Nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Not death nor life, not angels nor demons, not our fears for today nor our worries for tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. So as others celebrate Valentine's Day on Tuesday, give yourself a big hug and remind yourself you have the greatest love of all time. Now, let's hear from Rick with his sermon called Playing Favorites, the Ins and Outs of Exclusion. God love you this week.
In his autobiography, Mahatma Gandhi talked about how when he was a young man, he was really, really disturbed at the caste system in India. The caste system separated people into groups. And at one point, he decides he's going to go to a local church and he wants to speak to a pastor because he says to himself, if Christianity has a solution to the caste problem, then this is something that I need to take seriously. So he goes to a worship service one Sunday, intent on speaking to the pastor after the service is over. And when he walked in the door, and he was clearly a Hindu, whoever was greeting people said, "What are you doing here? You can sit over there." And he did. But on his way out, after everything he'd heard, he said to himself, "If Christianity has no solution to the problem of inequality, I may as well remain a Hindu." And he did. And just think of the impact that that man could have had, had he received a much different reception when he went to that one worship service. And yet we know that that is not an isolated case, that even today around the world, there are many places, both sophisticated in our view and unsophisticated, where people go to worship, where they want to encounter the risen Lord, and they are stymied by this social setting that says, you are not as good as we are, and so you can sit on the floor, you can sit over there. And I want to bring to your attention today that there are some reasons why that is just not acceptable in the eyes of God. There are some spiritual reasons why we need to avoid favoritism. And there are some practical reasons why we need to avoid favoritism. And there are some eternal reasons why that must be the case. We live in a society where equality is talked about all the time. We pride ourselves on our democracy and the way in which we treat each other. And yet, so often, when it comes to our individual relationships and sometimes even our church relationships, we just don't see things working out the way they're supposed to. And this is downright offensive to God. And when you were going through the text with James, I hope you saw that God is angry about what he calls a sin, this exclusion of other people. And we're going to get to James in a minute, but I want to call your attention to something that's in Genesis. Because you've heard this passage before. In Genesis 1, God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit says, let us make man in our image. Now, what does that mean? You probably grew up in a church that said, well, the fact that God gives us a spirit makes us like him in nature. That's what it means to be in the image of God. And I would not disagree with that. But I think that we often forget that that was such a radical view, not just all those years ago when the words were first written, but even today. Let's go back millennia and understand that this idea that God, a divinity, could pour himself into human form in some way was not exactly a new idea. But what the people in the ancient world believed was that when God allowed himself, or when the gods allowed themselves, in every other case, to dwell in human beings, it was almost always just the king or the rulers or the elite. Right on down to the Romans. That's why they deified their emperors, because they believed that the image of God had actually become part and parcel of this human being. But it only happened if you were a certain kind of person in the world. And so when God comes along and he says to the Hebrews, we will make God's image part of human image, that's a radical concept, unlike anything that had ever been heard before. It wasn't just the elite that would be part of God's image. We would all bear the stamp of his nature and his love. And so when James writes and he talks about how these people are being excluded, it's like we are marring the very image of God himself. It reminds me of a Roman mosaic where they had on the ground done this beautiful, beautiful artwork of a Roman emperor. And while the mortar was still setting, a dog comes along and puts his paw right on the face of the emperor, mars the whole picture. But when we allow our pride or our arrogance or our lack of love to get in the way of the right relationships we're supposed to have with each other, that mars the image of God. God wants no part of that. In Romans chapter 2, verse 11, God says he doesn't play any favorites. And we know that. When we look at all of the scripture, we can see that he is the one who tears down the barriers. He is the one who makes it possible for everyone to be acceptable and accessible to him. And that's why I think some of this must be so offensive to him, because we're just going in opposite directions to everything that he wants us to do. So let's just go for a minute to Acts chapter 10, and I'll show you exactly what he says when he talks about not playing favorites, because it's really important for us to understand, I think, that this is the way that God himself operates, and that's why he wants us to be in right relationship with each other. So in chapter 10 of Acts, and beginning in verse 34, this is what he says. I see, Peter says, I see clearly that God doesn't show partiality. In every nation, he accepts those who fear him and do what's right. I'm sure you've heard about the good news for the people of Israel, that there is peace with God through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. Not just Lord of some, but Lord of all. You know what happened all through Judea, beginning in Galilee, after John the Baptist began preaching. And no doubt you know that God anointed Jesus at Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. And then Jesus went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And that's the point. God was with him. But more than that, God is with us. He doesn't play favorites, and he does not want us to play favorites either. I love the saying that says that at the foot of the cross, the ground is level. That's right. At the foot of the cross, the ground is level. There is no one who is elevated. There is no one who exalted except God himself. And we really need to understand that in our relationships with each other in the church, we are to be beacons of that. And yet, so often that's not the case. And if you look at what was happening in the first century here, they made a wonderful start, but then things went totally off the rails. Totally off the rails. Do you know that in the beginning, we're told that in Acts 2 and in Acts 4 again, there were no needy people among the Christians because everybody gave what they had. They pooled their resources and they made sure that everyone was going to be okay. People would sell property and then give the proceeds to the church so that it might be distributed to the poor. We know that sometimes when the early Christians had communion, slaves and masters would gather together, and the masters would sometimes serve their slaves communion to demonstrate equality in the eyes of God. And that was the way it was meant to be, right from the very beginning. And yet we get to James, and even though the church is still relatively new, relatively young, what we see here is that they've lost sight of that wonderful equality that they had in those earlier days. He says, when the rich come in, you give them preferential treatment. You give them the best seats in the house, and to everyone else, the shabby, to the poor, to the disadvantaged, you say, well, you can sit over there, or you can sit on the floor. Because what they were doing is they were catering to the rich and the powerful. Now, let me just ask you a question. Why would they do that? They want something. And we see this all the time, even in the church today. And I'm really grateful that we have not had this problem here, but it doesn't mean that we won't ever. There are indeed churches today where if you have status, if you have power, and you have position, and you have prestige, you can walk in and you're going to get a different kind of treatment than everybody else. And sometimes that's because the church thinks it can benefit from that. Sometimes it's individuals thinking the same thing. Do you know what the difference is between gossip and flattery? Gossip is when you will say something behind somebody's back that you would never say to their face. And flattery? Flattery is when you'll say something to somebody's face that you'd never say behind their back, largely because it isn't true. My favorite definition of flattery is it's feeding somebody with an empty spoon. And yes, there are times when we need to be complimentary. We need to express appreciation, but it must always be genuine, and it must be motivated by the right reasons. We don't tell people how wonderful they are so that they're going to give us something or bless us in return. We simply point out what it is that we appreciate about people in a genuine and loving way. But that's not what was happening in this place. There were people who were being elevated and others who were being discriminated against purely because of what was happening in their lives and their station. And that makes no sense when you look at how Jesus dies for everyone and expresses that equality has to be part and parcel of what's happening. And yet sometimes I think even in the church today, we struggle with these things. I distinctly remember when a really good and close friend of mine came to me one day because In the congregation we were part of at the time, one of the things we did right was we welcomed in everybody. And there were a collection of people from an agency in town that had severe emotional, physical, and mental disabilities. And we welcomed them in. The place was jammed with wheelchairs, and we had lots going on with them. I remember my friend coming to me one time saying, "You know, I'm really concerned about this. You know, people come in, they're going to see all this, and they're just not going to react well." He wasn't looking at these people as human beings. He wasn't looking at them as those who bear the image of God. He was looking at what some people might think. I was horrified. I was offended that somebody would worry that that should be a consideration in our thinking. And yet we know that there are still people who do get preferential treatment. Maybe their family's been in the church for generations. Maybe they have some wealth and they're big donors to the church. And we have heard about situations where people who give lots feel a sense of entitlement to make decisions that nobody else gets to make. And there are still churches where wealth speaks louder than anything else. And let's not get too smug here either, because even if that may not be a situation here, because frankly, not much of you have got anything. Even if that's not the case here, there are other ways in which we play favorites. So if we exclude money, what are some of the other ways in which we often express favoritism in the church? What do you think? Sometimes if we have a sense that somebody is involved in sin or they're involved in things in their lives they should not be, instead of reaching out and instead of loving them and instead of speaking the truth, what we often do is we back away. We treat them differently. And it doesn't take long before that becomes very obvious to them. And that creates a barrier that makes reconciliation and repentance so much harder. But if it's not our behavior, what else can set us apart? Giftedness. We better treat them well. We better hold on to them, because look at what they could do. Look at what they have. Look at who they are. And there are ways in which that can translate into material blessings for the church. And so, yes, we have to be careful. You know, it's funny that Jane should say that, because I remember shortly after Herb and Jane arrived, they were expressing to me that they'd been to several congregations looking for a place where they might land. One of the disturbing things I remember to this day that they told me is that if they went to a church with their grandkids and their kids, they got one reception. And if they went to some congregations, and I stress some, just themselves as a mature couple, they got a different reception, because there was a sense in some places that if you were young and if you had energy and you had youth and you had vitality, then you had more to offer, and perhaps maybe we should just treat you a little bit better. I talked to a couple of people not all that long ago who said that they were part of a congregation here in town, but they felt like there was a concerted effort on the part of the leadership to discourage older people from coming because they wanted to appeal to younger families, and that was going to be their emphasis. And although that was never said out loud, that was clearly something that was happening. And there are, ladies and gentlemen, lots of Christians in this city and lots of places elsewhere where they are older and they feel like they are no longer valued. So even age or health can set us apart. Education can be a barrier. The giftedness we've already talked about can get in the way. There are all sorts of elements, all sorts of considerations where if we're not careful, it can divide us instead of bringing us together. Status is a terrible thing when it's allowed to supplement the image of God. We need to be loving each other because of who we are, our identity, and our shared purpose, and our common destination. Those are the things that hold us together. And James says, if anything gets in the way of that, it's simply not true. And we've seen in our own lives how those kinds of divisions can do so much damage. No doubt about that. Notice what James goes on to say here. You insult the poor. You cater to the rich, and yet it's the rich who are exploiting you. The spiritual end says we're all created in the image of God, so we all should be treated equally. The practical says, look, if all you're going to do is look at what's happening in your life, understand that it's not the poor who are giving you the problems. It is the landowners. It is those who refuse to pay a fair wage. It is those who will not give you the money you've earned. It is those who think that they are better than you and go out of their way to make that a reality in the cultural life. The rich at that time, many of them, were exploiting the poor. Jesus and James both say, you know, the rich, they have many barriers to coming to Christ. The poor have few of those barriers comparatively, and in many ways it's easier for them to embrace Christ because they have less to love. Sometimes options get in our way. And Jesus talked about how the rich have a especially hard time coming to faith because there are so many distractions and so many other things that get in the way. The poor are not noble because of their poverty. Don't get me wrong. Some of the most miserly, mean-spirited people I've ever met in my entire life were poor. So having little money does not make you noble. But it does mean that there are many ways in which perhaps you're not going to have to struggle like some of the rich do. And in 1 Timothy 6, Paul goes out of his way to say, look, you've got to have your right priorities. Don't trust in your money, which is so uncertain, but lay up treasure in heaven, just as Jesus said. Make sure that if you have money, that you're using it generously to bless others and to share with other people. That's the calling. And so the rich were welcome. The poor should have been just as welcome. And we all have a part to play as we bless the lives of one another. That's the way it was designed from the very beginning. Yes, indeed, it's good when you truly obey the Lord's royal command found in the scripture. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if you pay special attention to the rich, you're committing a sin, for you're guilty of breaking the law. And there seems to be an implication here, by the way, that some of the people that might have been guilty of this partiality, they were saying, well, look, you know, I'm faithful to God. Look at what I'm doing. I'm keeping all of what Jesus wants. Well, maybe not quite. James seems to be saying here, it's not good enough to keep just the rules that we like and to embrace the commands and the ways of Christ when it's convenient and when we want to, and then ignore the things that we don't. He's saying here, the royal law of Jesus is love. Not just love when we find it convenient and for those that we like, but for everyone. Everyone who keeps all the laws except one is as guilty as the person who's broken all of God's laws. In other words, this commandment to treat each other lovingly and equally and with dignity, that's vital. Because if you break that, it's like you're breaking all of the law. So we don't get to pick and choose. That's essentially what he's trying to say here. He says, so whatever you speak or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law of love, the law that set you free. Free from barriers, free from exclusion, free from the anger of God who wipes that away because Jesus pays the price for us. And that is the basis for our equality, not somebody's standing or their station. For there will be no mercy for you if you have not been merciful to others. But if you have been merciful, then God's mercy toward you will win out over his judgment against you. Which goes back to what Jesus said in the very beginning. The standard of judgment that you apply to others will be applied to you. And so if you're excluding people from the kingdom, if you're keeping people away from the church, then that is so serious that that can impair God's ability to welcome you. Because he will not have us mar his image in the lives and the hearts of other people. Gandhi could have been such a powerful force for the kingdom. Think for just a moment about how that man is revered today. Think about the impact he had, not just on India, but the world as a whole. And think about what might have happened had he been given the opportunity to embrace the love of of Christ in a meaningful, equal way that demonstrated that, yes, this faith of ours has something different to offer. Because if we will not welcome people in and treat each other the way God wants us to, people are going to notice. And one of the reasons why the churches are so empty in so many places today is because the world has seen the harsh judgment of Christians who say, you can't come in, not till you fix this. You can't be part of us, not until you embrace that. You can't be a Christian until you clean up your act or until you meet our standards. And we'll never know how many good and godly people those attitudes have chased away and cost the kingdom dearly. May God bless us this week as we try to be inclusive, not exclusive. Let's be image bearers. Let's not be image destroyers.